Well, I just want to say how much of a blessing it's been for me to be here with you this past week. Well, thank you, brother. I wish it could have been, longer, of course, but I think the Lord is definitely doing a significant work in the life of this church, and I'm looking forward to hearing testimonies about what God is going to do in the future. I'm thankful for your pastor and his invitation to have me here. You may not know, I guess it's okay for me to say, it's already on social media, I guess, but he is going to have Bubba and I back next year at the same time. And so praise the Lord, amen. And so we are looking forward to that already. Just know that you're loved, not only by your pastor, but I love you too. And as I look out across this room, I'm going to remember your faces. And even though I may not know all your names, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to remember your faces, and I'm going to pray for you. And trust God to continue to do a work in your hearts, to continue to do a work in this church, so that this church, in turn, can do a work in this community. I need your prayers, because to be real honest with you, typically, you know, just like your pastor, When preachers get up to preach, we like to be prepared, fully prepared. You know, I know when I preach on Sunday, you know, I spend anywhere from, you know, probably, you know, altogether 15 to 20 hours just on one message. You know, praying through the scripture, looking at the text, diagramming the sentences, all those things to make sure. Because when a preacher stands up in the pulpit, he needs to have command of the text. It needs to have command of him, and he needs to have command of it. He needs to know what it's about. He needs to know where he's going. And so that's something I'm very passionate about. And we don't believe that that's away from the Holy Spirit. We believe that the Holy Spirit leads us through that process. And the reason I need your prayers is because I'm not going to do that tonight. matter of fact, I was in the hotel room this morning. I was reading through some scripture. And God put a passage on my heart. I jotted down a few things, thinking that it was probably going to be a sermon that God wanted me to prepare for another time. So I'd already had the message I was going to preach, and I was going to preach you a phenomenal message from Nehemiah. Yeah. But I was in your pastor's office a few moments ago. And he's like, "So, what are you going to preach?" And I was like, "Well, I'm going to preach from Nehemiah tonight." And I said, "But if I had more time, boy, I'd really like to preach this Jeremiah passage." And, of course, he said, "Well, if that's on your heart, maybe you should pray about it. That's what the Lord wants." And I wish he wouldn't have said that. Because it turned out to be great advice. Let's pray together. Father, I pray for your blessing tonight upon the preaching of your word. And God, as you well know, that this is not comfortable for preachers, but you call us to get out of our comfort zone. And Lord, to be real honest with you, I know that this congregation wants to hear from you. I know that. I can see that. I can sense that. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help them to receive this message tonight. This is a message, obviously, that you have specifically for this church, or you wouldn't have orchestrated the events like you have. And so, Lord, I just want to be faithful. And so, Lord, I pray for our minds to be attentive. I pray for our ears to listen. I pray for our hearts to be receptive. And I pray that we would receive the Word of God tonight as the Word of God and not as a word of man. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, obviously, this message is for you. So here we go. Open your Bibles to Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 4. It could be that this message is just for your pastor. He didn't think about that. Open your Bibles there to Jeremiah chapter 4. Now, what I'd like for us to do is just to read there Let's go ahead and read. I don't know that I'll preach all these verses, but let's go ahead and read all the way through verse 10. So Jeremiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 10. Now let me just tell you what this is about. The Lord is basically telling the nation of Israel that they cannot return to their homeland. Now remember, they've been taken, you know, they're going to be taken into captivity in God because of their apostasy, because they've worshipped idols, they've turned away from God. And basically God is telling them, you will not be allowed to go to your homeland unless you genuinely repent. You're not going to be allowed to go back to your homeland unless you genuinely repent. And so what we have in this passage of Scripture is a call to genuine repentance. It's a call to revival through genuine repentance. With that in mind, let's read. Look at what he says in chapter 4, verse 1. If you return, O Israel, declares the Lord, to me. Let me back up. If you return, O Israel, declares the Lord, to me you should return. If you remove your detestable things from my presence and do not waver. If you swear as the Lord lives in truth and justice and in righteousness, then nations shall bless themselves in him, and in him they shall glory. For thus says the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. Circumcise yourselves to the Lord. Remove the foreskin of your hearts, O men of Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my wrath go forth like fire and burn with none to quench it because of the evil of your deeds. Declare in Judah and proclaim in Jerusalem and say, blow the trumpet through the land, cry aloud and say, assemble, let us go into the fortified cities. Raise a standard toward Zion. Flee for safety. Stay not, for I bring disaster from the north and great destruction. A lion has gone up from his thicket. A destroyer of nations has set out. He has gone out from his place to make your land waste. Your cities will be ruins without inhabitant. For this, put on sackcloth, lament and wail. For the fierce anger of the Lord has not turned back from us. In that day, declares the Lord, courage shall fail both king and officials. The priests shall be appalled and the prophets astounded. Then I said, O Lord God, surely you have utterly deceived this people and Jerusalem, saying, it shall be well with you, whereas the sword has reached their very life. The point is things will go well for them if they'll repent and turn back to God. I want you to know that I love my wife. Man, I do. I love her more. The reality is, the closer I get to God, the more I love her. Right? That's a fact. If you don't love your wife the way you should, it's because you're not loving God the way you should. It's vice versa. So the more I love God, the more I flow in love for my wife. And so I say all that to say, man, I love my wife. So I don't want you to think I'm disrespecting her in any way from what I'm about to tell you, because she would laugh knowing that I said this. My wife, when she wants to cook, she's a good cook. Okay? When she wants to cook, now some of you can testify. When she wants to cook, she's a good cook. In other words, when her heart is in it, she can cook good. But I'm going to tell you something. When her heart's not in it, I don't want her cooking. Now, we had a talk about this the other day. I said, honey, I just want you to know, it's okay if you don't feel like cooking. Now, when you want to cook, you go right ahead. But I want you to know, it's fine with me. If when you don't feel like cooking, you don't have to cook. Because to be real honest with you, honey, when your heart's not in it, it's hard to bear sometimes. And my boys were like, hey, man. And so there was agreement. When your heart's not in something, it really affects what you do, doesn't it? I can remember one of my boys was playing coach pitch baseball, and boy, his heart was not in it. He'd walk up there to the plate with his bat, And that coach would throw the ball, and he'd swing before the ball ever left the coach's, I mean, the pitcher's hand. I mean, he didn't care. He was just wanting to, and it wasn't even a hard swing. It was just like, and he and I had a long talk, and he likes chocolate. And the next game, I told him, I said, I'll buy you the biggest Snickers candy bar you've ever seen in your life if you'll just get up there and take a cut, son. Act like you care. Act like your heart's in it. Well, he did, and I bought him a Snickers candy bar. But the point is when your heart's not in something, it's obvious to everyone. And more importantly, it's obvious to God. God knows. Now, you may be able to fool some people, but God knows when our heart's not in something, doesn't he? Now, I want you to think about that in the context of repentance. You've heard about repentance this week, and the responsibility that we have to repent. I'm convicted that many in the church today go through the motions of repentance, but their heart's not in it. And what I mean by that is there's no true repentance. What we see in this passage of Scripture is God calling out his people for going through the motions of repentance, but knowing their hearts not in it. God's not fooled. God knows our hearts, and he knows whether or not our repentance is genuine. So I want you to be honest tonight. I want you to reflect upon your attitude toward sin. Now listen, not somebody else's sin. Not even the sin of our nation. I want this to be personal tonight. I want you to reflect upon your sin and your attitude towards sin. Because where I'm going with this message is this. I want to know by the time this message is over if whether or not you have genuinely repented of sin. If you are genuinely repenting of sin. Because that's where God wants us. God wants us to be. Now listen, God wants us to be repentors. That means that throughout your whole Christian life, your life ought to be characterized by constantly repenting. And that repenting ought to be real. If we truly expect for God to bring revival. Now, in this passage of Scripture, I got three things to share with you. In this passage of Scripture, first of all, we have an admonition that is directed toward revival. Now notice what God says. Notice this admonition that is directed toward revival. He says there in verse 1, "If you return, O Israel, declares the Lord, if you return to me, you should return." Now look at what he says. "If you remove your detestable things from your presence, and do not waver." You see that? "And do not waver. If you swear as the Lord lives in truth and justice and in righteousness." Look here. The promise of revival. "Then the nations shall bless themselves in him, and in him shall they glory. For thus says the Lord to the men of Judah." And notice who he's saying it to. Men. "For thus says the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and sow not among the thorns." And let's stop there at verse 4. "Circumcise yourselves to the Lord." Now, before we get to verse 4, I want to just camp out on the fact that what we have here is a clear admonition that is directed towards revival. It hasn't been that they haven't expressed repentance. The fact of the matter is that their repentance is insincere. And I believe that is the true pandemic in our society. I believe that is the pandemic that is hurting the church. You can have church members who will show up on church on Sunday morning and they'll hear the pastor preach the word of God, They'll hear the pastor preach that we should have hearts for the glory of God. They'll hear the preacher preach on a blood-stained cross and an empty tomb and the promise of Christ's coming. And they'll hear the preacher preach against things like backbiting and slander and gossip and unforgiveness. And even there'll be those who say, amen. And for a moment, perhaps, there's conviction. And a subtle whisper of I'm sorry to God. But within an hour or within a day, the bitterness is still there. The slander is still there. The gossiping is still there. The swearing and the cussing is still there. The lust, the pornography, the lust of the heart, the flesh, the eyes, the materialism, the covetousness, it's all still there. And week after week, God hears the subtle whisper, I'm sorry. Without sincere repentance. Here we have an admonition that is directed toward revival. And what is the admonition? Return to God. He says, and do not waver. Remove the detestable things from your presence. And do not waver in doing it. The second thing that we see here is that this admonition has drastic requirements. The admonition has drastic requirements. Look at what he says. This is where we get back to verse 4. And by the way, I know these sermons aren't fun to hear. They weren't for the nation of Israel or Judah either. In verse 4, he says, notice the requirement of the admonition. Break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns. So, of course, Jeremiah uses two illustrations that that Judah could really understand. He uses the illustration of an unplowed field. It's the idea that no farmer is going to go out and sow seed among the thorns or the weeds. No farmer is going to go out and sow seed among a field where the dirt hasn't been turned over, where the field hasn't been plowed. So when he says to Judah, break up your fallow ground and sow not among thorns, he is saying to them, let every one of you search your heart. And especially the men, right? We already saw that. He says, let every one of you search your heart. It's a call to brokenness. It's not a call to a silent whisper. It's not a call to repetition without meaning. You know what I'm talking about? Repetition without meaning. It's where you commit the same sins over and over and you tell God every time you're sorry, but then you keep on doing it. It's a call to brokenness. It's a call to be broken over what we have done against God. See, that's the reason I preached the first day I was here, or the second time, that God would give us a renewed vision of His holiness, right? And coming with that is a renewed vision of the sinlessness or the sinfulness of sin. When we become awfully aware of just how holy God is, and then we become the reality of sin's wickedness begins to manifest itself in His heart, God says, when that happens, my desire is for you to be broken over sin. It's brokenness that leads to genuine repentance. And by the way, as I told you before, drastic requirements, God is calling for brokenness. And then we also see the drastic nature of the admonition's requirement when he says in verse 4, circumcise yourselves to the Lord, remove the foreskin of your heart. What's he saying? I want every aspect of who you are, body, mind, and soul. I want every aspect of who you are to be consecrated to me. I want your heart to be broken over sin, and I want you to circumcise your heart. I want you to be dead to the world. I want you to be dead to sin, and I want you to be totally consecrated to me. Now listen, this is the desire of God. This is the command of God. I just come as his messenger. So notice what we have here, beloved, in this passage of Scripture. We have a clear admonition. And what is it? If you desire revival, repent of sin. And the requirements are that you be broken. And that every aspect of who you are be totally surrendered to God. Now I ask you right now, are you broken over sin? Not only sins of commission, those are the ones that we know we ought to be repenting of. We know we ought to be repenting of the things I've mentioned, lying, swearing, cursing, gossiping, backbiting, pot stirring. Those are the things that I hope we know, that we ought to be broken over. The things that we ought to be confessing before God and agreeing with God that these are wicked and they are manifestations of a depraved nature. These are the very things that Christ went to the cross and died for. And so, God, I confess them as wicked, and I agree with you that they are sinful. But what about the sins of omission? Sins of commission are those sins that we commit that we know we shouldn't do. The sins of omission are just that, omitting things that we know we should do. Prayer. Evangelism, scripture reading, meditation, scripture memory, giving, fasting. We ought to be just as broken over the sins of omission as we are over the sins of commission. So I ask you tonight, dear church, not in any way to be hurtful, but to be helpful. When is the last time that you got on your face before God in gut-wrenching repentance because of how ugly you were towards another person, or how short and snappy you were towards another individual? When is the last time that you just fell before God and cried out in brokenness and pled before God to wash you and to cleanse you and to forgive you? When is the last time you just said, Lord, forgive me for trampling underfoot the blood of Christ? He shed his blood. He died for me in order to set me free. But God, just like a dog that returns to its vomit, I keep going back. Oh God, help me. Oh God, break me. Oh God, help me to circumcise my heart, my life, my mind, my all. To die to myself and to surrender my life to you, holy as Lord. And I'm not talking about people getting saved. I'm talking about Christians getting right with God. You say, preacher, why do you preach this way on the last night? Because you wouldn't have come back. Yeah, you would. You want this. I know you do. We want this type of preaching, don't we? For those of us who desire to be close with God, we don't shun this. We embrace it, don't we? We say, oh, how I need to hear that. And those of us who know our Bibles, we recall, I got to show you something, beloved. This is the only time in the Bible where it says this. There's only one time in the Bible where God says he doesn't despise something. What if I told you there's one thing you can do that God does not despise? For sure, because he says it. You know the one thing that God doesn't despise? The only time he says it in the Bible is a broken and contrite heart. Do you remember the context for which he said that? When King David sinned against God with Bathsheba, and the preacher came to him. He said, you're the man. You're the one who have sinned against God and sinned against your brother. And when David was convicted of sin, I'm sure up until this point, he gave God a whisper. But now he gives God a cry. Have mercy on me, O God, he says. Psalms 51. According to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, Lord, I was brought forth in iniquity, and sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth, and in the inward being, you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Beloved, when have you cried out to God like that? Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. When is the last time that you were so broken over sin that you literally felt like your bones were breaking? Hide your face from my sins. Blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise, for you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Glory. Amen. Praise the Lord. As much as I sin, I can give that to the Lord. You say, Pastor, why don't we repent like that? You know, right? Let's just be honest. Because we're too busy. We're too busy to be still and know that he is God. We are too busy just to marinate and to meditate upon his holiness. We're too busy to read through scripture that reveals our sin to us. The Bible's full of lists of sins. When's the last time you just read one of those lists and confessed every one there that God mentions? We've got to be still. We've got to be hungry. We've got to be honest. We've got to be willing to take the time and to slow down and push the world away. And just get alone with God. And we ought to be taking time for daily cleansing. I'll be honest with you tonight. Before we even get to the invitation, I'm going to be asking you to pray for God to break your heart over sin. One of our beautiful sisters on the screen just a few moments ago, and this is one of the things, I wasn't convinced to preach this sermon until she read this verse. 2 Chronicles 7:14. I was still battling right there in the pew. And I was like, well, she read it. I've got it down in my notes. Well, let's go with it. 2 Chronicles 7:14. You remember? Now listen, we quote this all the time, but listen, we're talking about the drastic, there's a drastic requirement here, isn't it? Notice what it is. It's not come to church and feel sorry about you, what you did, give the Lord a gentle whisper, and then keep living like you always have. And we wonder why we haven't experienced revival in our nation. Because we need the people of God to be broken and cry out to God for cleansing and washing, renewal, revival. Look at what he says here in 7:14. You know the verse. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. There's nothing common about that. There's nothing fast about that. There's nothing shallow about that. It is drastic, aggressive repentance, humility, and prayer. Consistent, fervent, calling out to God. As we make our way back to Jeremiah, the admonition also indicates personal responsibility. God holds every Christian responsible. Two verses with nine imperatives. Nine commands. Look at what he says. Verse 5. Declare to Judah. There's one. Proclaim in Jerusalem. Say, blow a trumpet through the land. Cry loud and say, assemble, let us go into the fortified city. Raise a standard toward Zion. Flee for safety. Stay not. Notice what he's saying to the people of God. Declare, proclaim, blow the trumpet, cry aloud, say, assemble, let us go. Raise a standard. Flee for safety. Stay not. Every one of them, especially the men. Every one of them is held personally responsible by God himself. And so I say to us, it's easy to look in a church like this and say, well, the pastor needs to pray that way. Well, the deacons ought to be praying that way. The Sunday school teachers and directors and whoever, they ought to be praying that way. That's what we hire them for. I know you don't think that way. I'm just got to come up with some preaching stuff, right? Listen to me. Everybody ought to be praying and repenting from every sin this way. Why? Why? You say, Pastor, I'm saved. I've given my life to Jesus. Praise the Lord. But one of the reasons that we ought to be praying this way as the church is because people are dying and going to hell without Christ. And that is one of the primary reasons the church needs to be revived. Is not so much for our joy to be restored, which is a byproduct, but for the lost to experience a joy that they've never had. We look at this passage of Scripture, and he talks about raise a standard towards Zion, flee for safety, stay not. Verse 6, for I bring disaster from the north. Great destruction. A lion has gone from its thicket. A destroyer of nations has set out. It has gone out from his place to make your land a waste. Your cities will be in ruin without inhabitants. And because this is happening, because Christ is coming, and all those who are lost will be separated from God for all eternity. Because Christ is coming, and when he comes, it'll be too late for the lost to be saved. There'll be no turning to Christ and genuine salvation at that point. It'll be too late. Therefore, verse 8, put on sackcloth, church. Lament, well. Cry out to God. Brokenness. Circumcise your heart. Fully surrender yourself to the Lord. For the anger of the Lord has not turned back. Now, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. For those of us who are saved, we have no reason to fear the wrath of God. We are clothed with Christ's righteousness. We are adopted children, joint heirs with Jesus, sealed by the Holy Spirit, redeemed, forgiven. But what about those who aren't? What about those who are lost? You know what a lack of repentance will do? It will grieve the Holy Spirit in your life. It will quench the Spirit of God. When the Spirit is grieved, when the Spirit is quenched, you will not be broken over souls the way you should. Christ is coming. And for the believer, it's a beautiful thing, isn't it? It's a beautiful thing. Believers, those of us who are saved, have no reason to fear the second coming of Christ. No reason to fear whatsoever. Because for the believer, the second coming is a bridegroom coming back for his bride. It's our blessed hope. It's the source of our joy to know that when Christ returns, we shall receive glorified bodies, made perfect, never to be separated from those whom we love who are in Christ. No more weeping, no more tears, no more heartache, no more pain, new heavens and a new earth. But for those who are lost, it's a terrible day of God's wrath. And so many of them that walk by you every day are not even aware. And so often we are not even aware. Because we have grieved the Spirit through our lack of genuine repentance. So I call the church tonight. I say unto you, blessed congregation, let this not just be a week of good singing and decent preaching. Let this be a spark that ignites a flame. I'm asking for you to come and fill this place tonight, this altar, this pew here, standing up, whatever. And I'm asking you to come and ask God. I'm preaching to the Christian now. Ask God to help you to see sin as he does. To ask God to break your heart over sin. Ask God to break your heart over the lost. To see sin as he sees sin. To see the lost as he sees the lost. That you would ask God to bless you with the gift of genuine repentance. And that from now on until the rest of your life, that you would be a repentor and not one who simply whispers, I'm sorry, God. So here in a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand. And I'm going to ask the church to come and pray for that specific thing I just challenged you with, the admonition that we receive from the Word of God. that we would no longer take lightly what God has called us to forsake, that we would no longer hold back that which God has called us to give, and that we would no longer be silent concerning that which God has called us to proclaim. There's power, folks. I'm going to tell you something right now. There's power in this place tonight. You could be the spark that God uses to ignite a flame. But those of you who are lost, I'm telling you, if you have not given your life to Christ, then you are trampling underfoot the blood of Christ. You're saying that his death upon the cross is nothing. You're saying that it doesn't matter. And there's nothing that awaits for you but the fearful expectation of divine judgment that will come from a holy God who absolutely hates sin. But Christ died for you. God gave his Son for you. Christ took your sin upon himself, and he went to the cross and he died in your place so that you can be saved and forgiven, adopted into the family of God, join as with Jesus. Would you surrender your life to him tonight? No more pride, no more procrastination, but humility and surrender. When I ask you to stand, your pastor will be down front. You come to him and you surrender your life to him and be saved. Bubba, do you guys come? Father in heaven, Father in heaven, as your word has gone forth tonight, I know that your word will not return void. I know that your spirit is at work now. And I pray for genuine, heartfelt response from everybody. For those who are lost, snatch them tonight as a brand from the flame and grant them life. And for those of us who are saved, may we ask you to bless us with the gift of brokenness, repentance, and absolute and total surrender. That this day, every believer would stand, kneel, or pray, and with resolute hearts, we would say, by God's grace, I will live the rest of my days as a repentor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand and come now as the Lord leads you?